Hello, I'm EnterElysium and welcome back to World War K. Now there's an enemy fleet off the coast who are there to perform interdiction duties. But first of all, a lot of you wanted to know the fate of Jeb, Bill and Bob. So if we look here, Bill and Bob have both turned back up, but we don't know where Jeb is actually. He's currently missing in action. Now of course, Jeb is a well-known survivor and has come back from death several times. So we will, of course, wait for him to appear before declaring him dead, and it is very unlikely he is, because he's proven time and time again that he effectively cannot die, whatever you throw him. Anyway, the enemy flotilla is actually there to stop the Styx representative, who is on his way, from actually reaching the Kerbal Space Center, because he's headed over here to negotiate some sort of formal truce and limited alliance against our common foe, the Northern Allied Territories. Of course, the Northern Allied Territories don't want this to happen. I mean, who knows how they got hold of the information that was on its way. Maybe they've got some sort of really good intelligence service or something. We actually don't know. They haven't been a player on the global scale until recently. But anyway, they're there to stop him getting here. So we're going to have to stop this. We're going to have to intercept and destroy, or at least drive them off. And what better way to do it than with the new technology that they've swapped us in exchange for the prisoner transfer that we'll be doing. The prisoners that we got much, much earlier in the war, we've traded them back and we've given them our missile technology and they've given us the submarine technology. So what we're going to do is we're going to build an attack sub. Now we'll fit this out with some sort of maybe cruise missiles and some torpedoes, and we'll go and take on these patrol boats, because it looks like they're just generic patrol boats and they haven't been outfitted specifically to counter submarines, because of course submarines are a new development in this war. So their weapons probably aren't that effective at countering underwater threats. So this is our cunning plan. Now of course submarines have been around for a while. I mean, I think it was something like the 17th century that they were first proposed or created in any sort of manner, but it was several centuries later that we actually got anything that wasn't like actually propelled by human power itself. A lot of sort of technical invention and innovation with submarines actually came around during the American Civil War. Using them mainly to propel themselves up to ships and then drill in the side of ships and try and make them leak. Stuff like that. But it was the early 20th century that really saw submarines take off, because, of course, Germany's U-boats. Yeah, so that was the main innovations in submarines we saw. And, of course, submarines only really became much useful after torpedoes became incredibly useful. Torpedoes came around in the 19th century, I think, and they quickly, once of course, you know, they became reliable enough and got enough speed, became very popular because they were a way of relatively, how do I put this? It's much easier to aim a torpedo than it is to aim and hit with a standard gun, because a standard gun, you've got to think about range as well as a torpedo. Provided you're in the torpedo's range of fuel, the torpedo will run straight and true, so you've only got to worry about the left-right instead of the up-down as well. Now you can see here, of course, that we are still having pretty even problems with our technology. For some reason, we might have to play around with the allocation of the ballast and the float tanks here. Now, I think the most modern case of the sinking of a submarine that I can think of off the top of my head is the sinking of the Kursk, which happened in 2000. Now, some of you might remember it, probably a lot of you don't. It was a Russian submarine, a Russian cruise missile sub, I think, that was lost with all hands. And it wasn't lost to enemy action. What is most likely the case is, in fact, that while doing some torpedo drills, it went to fire a torpedo, or at least it was in the process of loading or arming a torpedo. And the compressed hydrogen peroxide that it used had somehow leaked through the rust and built up in the casing, and this increase in pressure had basically caused the torpedo to burst, propelling the front of the torpedo through the closed torpedo doors and basically making the sub sink pretty damn quickly. There was a second explosion heard after the first one was heard, which was likely something in the forward torpedo room exploding, or at least another burst of pressure. And the use of this compressed hydrogen peroxide to propelled torpedoes had been experimented with by the British in, I think it was post-Second World War. And the British, after they accidentally sank one of their own submarines from a very similar accident, but this was, I think it was in dock at the time or something, because I remember seeing a picture of it half out of water. It didn't go down with all hands at all. But the British quickly decided that it probably wasn't a good idea to use this stuff. It's a little bit too volatile. But anyway, now we're putting on the armaments. Now, here we're using torpedoes. I mean, I'd like to attach them to the side and have them going by decouplers, but as we've already ascertained, side decouplers don't really work because the weight of the decoupler is still on the thing that is released. And we want the weight of the decoupler to actually be on the original craft. Of course, you know, Squad, when they built KSP, weren't really imagining people to want the projectile or the thing that comes off the decoupler to be the thing flying true. They wanted the original craft to be flying true. So, in this case, we want the missile, or the torpedo, to be flying true. Now, of course, the way the buoyancy code works is, the submarine parts, like the baffles and, sorry, not the baffles, the ballast tanks, when they're attached to a vessel, they take over the buoyancy code. So instead of having the thing that floats randomly and does weird things, they then ascertain how heavy are you, how much ballast you have, and so on, and then it ascertains whether you should be floating or not. So when we detach these objects, I had to do some experiments to see whether they continue having the code now they're no longer attached, or whether they revert to their original state. Now they do continue to have the code, so we should be fine, but it will mean that they do fall underwater instead of floating. And what we really want them to do is float, or at least come near the surface and then continue onwards. So this is why I'm trying to ascertain at what angle I should be firing them to get them to have a roughly level trajectory. Of course, there won't be a perfect level trajectory as they will build up it thrust as they go. Now, some did mention why didn't I go for a top-down profile when attacking in the last one with the Styx missile sub. Now, the reason I did that is because I didn't think there would be enough fuel for the missile to be able to go both up and then down. However, it does make a lot of sense because it is somewhat easy to have to just go straight down and then angle, rather than having to worry about gravity constantly pulling you down and trying to get the flight path right. However, if you can, make sure the gravity isn't such an issue, flying level is probably a better... what's the word? Trajectory, as of course you only have to worry about the left to right again and not the up and down. But of course that means you have a flat level flight path that you don't have to worry about in the case of these. That's not really the case. So we're going to go for a fire up top and then drop down. Of course we could always, you know, fly underneath a ship and fire them. They work pretty well. And looking at them there, they've got maybe, I don't know, 5k of delta V. It's the reason I fired them off, is just to check how much delta V they've got. Or not how much delta V, how much flight distance. Delta V is slightly different. Delta V is much different. So, you know, ignore what I just said. There we go, just readjusting that. Now let's just do some sea trials with it. Now one famous use of submarines was the attack on the Tirpitz, the Scharnhorst, and I think it's the Ludlow, which were, a battleship and a heavy cruiser that belonged to the German Navy in the Second World War, and they were hiding in a fjord in Norway. And they were acting as a fleeting being, that is, a fleet that doesn't need to leave its port, but forces the enemy to deploy ships nearby to counter them if they left port. So in effect, they tie up enemy forces without having to do anything themselves. And we turn over because we're top heavy. We need to solve this problem. And now I have solved the problem by putting a stick on the bottom of the ship with a fuel tank attached. Yes, it looks very inelegant, but we need to intercept this enemy patrol, so forgive me. Anyway, the reason you don't really want to use your fleet in being as an actual fleet is because if you use it as an actual fleet, you might lose. And if you lose, then the enemy can redeploy their fleet. However, you can actually just sit the fleet in harbour, you know, very little maintenance cost, little running cost. No chance, very much a smaller chance of losing it, and you force the enemy to deploy their ships to counter yours. In the case of the Tirpitz, this was because its sister ship, the Bismarck, had already been sunk. Now, the Tirpitz and the Bismarck were scary ships. They were very powerful, very well armored, and very fast, and in effect acted as a fleet, or at least a small fleet, by themselves. That to counter that threat, the aged British fleet would actually have to put out several ships. So they were kind of a big deal at the time. All right, now I've solved what the problem was there, and let's just try out these. Now, for some reason, the missiles aren't firing. You notice I've got the throttle set to full. Missiles aren't firing. I have got make slow set, so if I take that off... Nope, doesn't work. Okay, let's turn the back engines back on. Huh. Okay, so somehow, because I had the back engines off... That's bizarre. Anyway, I haven't figured out what that was, but let's go. Gotta take the enemy ships out quickly and without too much fuss. There are still the issues you just saw with weapons. I don't know why they occasionally don't work. But we'll have to improvise. Anyway, the attack on the Tirpitz, the Scharnhorst, and the Ludlow was carried out by 6 mini-subs that were towed to the area by British subs. And these mini-subs were then to basically float in past these anti-sub nets, anti-torpedo nets, cut their way through, and then place charges. And they succeeded in damaging the Tirpitz really badly, but none of the crews actually made it home. I think two of the mini-subs were lost before they even got under their own steam. One of them disappeared. It suggested it maybe took a direct hit from one of the full-caliber guns of the battleships, which of course isn't good for anyone. Is anyone inside the sub? And I think the other two were captured. They were damaged after they attacked on the Tirpitz and were captured. I can't remember what happened to the sixth one. But there's an example of a World War II use of submarines. Now, if I were to be slightly more controversial and actually talk about a slightly more modern conflict, if we talk about the Falklands conflict, which... is technically not a war because no one declared war, but if I call it a war, for all intents and purposes, it was pretty much a war. Now, the General Belgrano was a Argentinian cruiser that was sunk by a British sub. It fired 3 torpedoes, 2 of them hit, and both hit actually outside the coverage of the Belgrano's heavier armour. And I think the one that hit the bow was outside of the torpedo bulge. Area. Now, torpedo bulge is where basically if you see like the hull of a ship just around the waterline, just below it, there should be a little bulge outwards on military ships. Now that's to basically it's full of air or water, or air and water in some cases. And basically if a torpedo hits that, the shock and the force of the torpedo is dissipated through that, and while that's damaged, that isn't integral to the actual ship's well-being. And that's there to dissipate these things. Now, the Belgrano took one at the back, behind the main coverage of the armour, took one at the front, behind before the coverage of the armour and before the torpedo bulge, and sank very quickly. Now, all the whole part of the why this is kind of sort of iffy to mention is because people say, oh, well, you know, it was leaving the conflict area, the maritime exclusion zone, and it turned away, and it shouldn't have been engaged. Now, if we take the actual words of the Belgrano's captain who survived, and I think if he wrote a book, and in the book he said, I was actually turning away temporarily because of sea conditions or something, and I was about to turn back. My orders were to engage anyone who came within range of my guns, and I thought the attack was fair itself. Now, that's paraphrasing. That's basically what he said. Now, the Maritime Exclusion Zone itself, people say, oh, it wasn't in the Maritime Exclusion Zone. The Maritime Exclusion Zone is not the... where people should be attacking other ships and aircraft and people, and outside of that everything's happy. The Maritime Exclusion Zone is basically where you tell merchant shipping and so on, don't enter here, it's a conflict zone. It doesn't apply to military ships in the same sense. Military ships are military ships wherever they are. If they're a current threat in the correct position, they're an issue. in that regard. It's why when people complain about border skirmishes and so on in regions where there's been artillery fire, and the media say, oh, it's terrible, they crossed the border, blah, 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 blah. In the case of modern warfare, where you have mobile warfare and you have mechanized infantry and you have artillery that can fire from miles and miles away, you need to have mobility of your troops and your assets. It's not static trench warfare as in World War One, and it's not going to have a dead, like a very defined front line. There will be a front line, but it won't be a perfectly defined, this is war, this is not war. So the people get quite confused about that. Of course, you know, I'm just a YouTuber. What do I know? If you want to accept anyone's word, I'd probably say you accept the word of the guy whose own ship was sunk. I mean, if he's falling down the side of, yeah, it was a fair cop, and he lost his ship and his crew, there's probably a little bit of merit to it, put it that way. But anyway, now we're close enough to the enemy ships. Of course, the one problem in KSP with water is I didn't think Squad ever intended people to go under the water like this, so of course there isn't a rendering of the water from below. We just have to accept that it's a funny little world in KSP. But we're getting close enough now that we can start to think about engaging. I just want a quick save here, because I have had the occasional funny bug. And by funny I mean, oh god, that's weird and annoying. There probably will be a bug episode come out of the bugs I've experienced in the last few. Bloopers thing. But you can see we're close enough that we can begin to engage. Now, on the way here, I was quite surprised by the sub's turn of speed. It managed to do about 90 miles an hour. Underwater. 90 miles an hour. At a depth of about, what, 150 meters? That's... bugger, that's unrealistic. We must have some crazy new tech. We must have improved upon the sticks technology for the subs. Somehow, I have no idea how. Obviously, modern warfare hasn't got to the stage where we've got this technology. The Kerbals must be far ahead of us. But we're going to open up by being directly under the ship. Now, this is a great opening maneuver because, of course, we can fire upwards. They can't fire downwards. This ship above us will have to maneuver. It's dangerous being at this close range if their weapons can actually reach underwater. They can damage us from the other ship. But this ship directly above us cannot because, of course, we're directly under it. But we can fire our missiles. So, let's just line ourselves up. Select one to fire. Maybe inch a little bit further forwards. And then fire. Direct hit. Can't see any damage, but let's have a go at the second one. Let's line the second one up. Oh, crap. There's a decoupler of some sort in there. I think that's a decoupler for the fuel tank at the bottom. Just so that when we have used our missiles and stuff, we can actually eject the bottom fuel tank. Right. I don't know what that did. That's meant to be firing it. I think it... one of the couplers says it's gone? I have no idea. But anyway. Let's fire again. Ready? And fire! Uh-huh. Well, that's certainly unique. Well, our opening salvo did bugger all then. Except for make the other ship listen in an amusing fashion. And now it's there go. Now they're firing the Gatling cannons at us. They don't seem to be penetrating the water, which, you know, is good for us. Oh, they're having a go with the missiles, though. And it didn't look like they penetrated the water. It looks like they just exploded on impact on the water surface. It's a bit unfair that they got to fire two weapons, but, you know, I suppose we got to fire two missiles. And of course, the ship directly above us isn't really able to do much from this angle, so they're going to have to fire up their engines. Now, these ships are incredibly slow. I think the top speed is something like 6 meters per second. It's nothing compared to our 90 miles an hour. Jesus, that's just insane. Anyway, it does mean that we've got a lot of fuel as well. So, we've got a very good cross-range capability in this. Oh, they're turning their guns. Looks like they're going to line up a missile shot. Unless they're planning on turning hard. Oh, that might be it for their go, actually. Yep, that's it for their go. Right. Now, I've avoided using the make still for saving ability, because although that's useful, I have had issues with it when you reselect the sub and then try move or decouple things, things not working, things exploding, and taking off in weird fashion. So, there are some drawbacks to this technology, so I've been trying to just leave it where it is, and you do seem to be able to change ship and so on fine. Let's fire up our engines. And I think we're going to try our last cruise missile. It's not really a cruise missile, it's an incredibly short-range ballistic missile. Cruise missile cruises, and a ballistic missile it describes a ballistic arc. In effect, it's got a parabola. There is a parabolic curve involved, or is something that describes something similar to it. There is a definite arcing. That's the best way to describe something ballistic. Just gonna line this up. Of course, we're nose down a bit because we've lost the weight on the back. And while I could just adjust the buoyancy and the ballast and the float and everything, our missile. Yep. Yeah. Okay. We have encountered this problem in testing, and we still don't know how it's solved. But now we just have a missile on top of us. Well, I just hope it doesn't go off. That would be a problem. But we have our torpedoes left. So, you know, four torpedoes. Four shots. They're meant to be fired in two pairs, but we can always fire them fours if we need to. But it's the enemy's go now. And I don't really know what they can do. Their weapons have proved entirely ineffective at getting below the surface of the water. Although, you know, admittedly our weapons so far have proved fairly ineffective. I mean, one out of three not firing. The other one exploding and doing no damage internally to the ship. And the other one exploding and just propelling the ship slightly upwards until it ran out of fuel. You know, because... bizarre. Weird. Anyway. Those missiles were even more impressive. Bugger all damage. Just bounced off the water, literally. And they only have the two salvos of missiles on board. I mean, each salvo is 10 missiles, and they're short range, light, not very good against armor. But if they hit our sub, they could probably do damage. I mean, the sub, there's no armor on that thing. It is a fuel tank, it's a cockpit, a few buoyancy tanks. If they took our buoyancy tank, we'd have real trouble. Whereas they're pretty much armor, and then on top of the deck is the weapons. Looks like it's moving to protect the rear of the ship. Suspecting maybe the rear's the weak point or something. Huh. Anyway. I think this is our go now. Now, we've only got four torpedoes, and there's two ships. That means two torpedoes of the ship. And they're the same things as the ballistic missiles. At this stage, I'm wondering what we can actually do to penetrate their armor. I mean, they've proven pretty good at not being tipped as well. I mean, we had an engine firing on one side for a while with that broken bit missile, but... they haven't been able to be tipped. But this means we need to adjust our buoyancy carefully. And the same problem happens again. We lose two torpedoes, which just fall off the front. That's rather annoying. Now, they've got no weapons that can really affect us. That's been proven. They can't get below the water. Their missiles, the only thing that could even have a chance of getting below the water, maybe. They're all gone. They've used them. So let's just adjust our buoyancy and take our next shot. Because there is literally nothing they can do to stop us. I mean, we're even just below the surface. They can't even ram us. We're just too far down. So we have all the advantages here, but even then, I think we're going to have to get these missiles to fire, and I think the only way to do that is, maybe if we set them... what if we were to activate them and then fire the decoupler manually? So if we were to basically do it by right clicks, turn on engine, activate decoupler, because I think what's happening is the decoupler's firing, but the engines aren't firing first, I don't know why. or even at the same time. So we activate engine, and then fires a decoupler. Just too low. That's a shame. Okay, and I've got a good feeling about this one. Gone. Oh, it was a good hit. Pushed them sideways a little bit. Did no damage whatsoever. That, well, that was an abject failure, I have to admit. The sub was parlantry at best. It was fast. Didn't do much else. The enemy ships, I think they've realised by now that we can't do much, so they're not really worrying about us anymore. Possibly some sort of redesign is needed with more effective weapons. Maybe we just fitted it with Gatling cannons? Underwater Gatling cannons of some kind? Some sort of special underwater cannon thing. Maybe. Or maybe just heavier missile. Those missiles were pretty light. And they didn't get much speed. They were, of course, using the very light engines to power them. It might be that they didn't have enough speed or something. Could well be the case. So next time, I think we need to outfit heavier weapons. This is the first time we've had a problem with our weaponry not being powerful enough. I mean, we've normally had problems with other stuff, but our weaponry not being powerful enough? Ah, well. I guess that's it, unless that cruise missile we're working on actually works. Let's try it. So you can see, this cruise missile designed to be fired from the KSC in event of an enemy attack, especially from the sea, because, you know, we fly towards the sea on takeoff. Now, I've got mech jeb on it, just so that if I wanted to use a mech jeb pilot to keep it at a flight altitude and a flight direction. However, I think I'm going to pilot this manually, because mech jeb has some problems with sea skimming on this. I've tried to tell it to fly at an altitude of like 5 meters, and it goes to about an altitude of 11, and it has trouble getting down any further. It doesn't want to for some reason. Maybe it realizes if it goes down, there is a small chance of crashing and dying. Now, this is just a probe core, a reaction wheel, an intake, a jet engine, a fuel tank, and a couple of wings, and mech jeb. So, very cost efficient. Now, I'm trying to keep a decent altitude here. I realize that once I hit the 2.2 kilometer barrier, there will be a frame rate stutter, and I know that this will make it difficult to fly for about 1 second while I don't get any updates on the screen. So, I'm going to be careful to pop up a tiny bit of altitude just before that, just so I don't accidentally crash into the ground while I can't actually control anything. Now, we're getting an insane turn of speed here. Something like 0.6 Mach at this altitude is fairly good. So the speed problem we had before isn't going to be a problem this time. Let's just hope I can actually aim this goddamn thing. Okay. Okay. Yes! Get in! Matt, ladies and gentlemen, is a win. However, look at the amount of damage we did. We took out one hull panel. I think we're going to definitely have to up our game in terms of our armament from now on. But I think that'll be enough to drive the enemy fleet off. Well, it wasn't really a fleet, it was more of a flotilla, a patrol, two ships, and there's only one. I think that'll drive it off, because we can keep firing these all day, they're so cheap. Anyway, I've been EnterElysium, and we actually have a success this time to report, which is our first success of the Empire in a while. So I've been EnterElysium, and stay shiny, everybody.